two annual reports are available on our website for easy access. And here I'd like to go into a little bit more specifics to justify our request to not be covered under the Act. The Sustainable Jobs Fund program was created by an act of the Vermont legislature and signed into law effective April 20, 1995. VITA in that bill was tasked with incorporating a nonprofit corporation for the purpose of administering the Sustainable Jobs Fund program. IRS nonprofit incorporation status was received in March 1996 under the organization name of the Vermont Sustainable Jobs Fund, Inc. Thus, the VSJF has been a separate legal entity with its own IRS legal status as of March 1996 and has operated as such since that time. As an independent 501c3 organization, we are managed by an 11-member board of directors. Eight of these directors are independently selected, while two are members of the administration, and one is appointed by the governor, who may or may not be a member of the administration. Currently, three out of the 11 board members are members of the administration. All board members attend quarterly board meetings, receive a written and oral report from our audit firm, JMM and Associates, each fall. They participate in strategic planning work with the staff, approve the organization's annual budget, and perform the standard legal and fiduciary responsibilities required under IRS rules for nonprofit organizations. In fiscal 19, only 27% of the VSJF's budget was provided by state sources in the form of grants and contracts, whereas 73% comes from federal and philanthropic funding sources, fees for service income, corporate sponsorships, and events. Any state funding support is requested or applied for and is not guaranteed year over year. So thus, we are not a line item as a standalone within the state budget. Grant agreements and or contracts are put in place between the VSJF and the granting or contracting agency, which outlines the work plan as it was proposed by the Sustainable Jobs Fund, not as dictated by the state entity. Interim and final grant reports and contract reports are required by state agencies providing the grant support and or contracts to the VSJF, and thus these documents are already publicly available if requests are made to the appropriate agency. VSJF makes its audited financial statement and IRS Form 990 publicly available upon request and via the website GuideStar. Annual reports for the VSJF can be found on our website in two different locations. So up until fiscal 15, the VSJF did provide a set of our audited financial statements to the Auditor of Accounts and the Office of Budget and Management for the purposes of inclusion in the state's CAFR. That year, and that was a historical thing that was set up way back at the beginning of the founding of the Sustainable Jobs Fund. And at that time, we were considered to be a component unit of the state. This predates me, so I don't really understand how that determination was made. But back then, I think because VITA had been originally assigned to set the Jobs Fund up as an independent nonprofit, and also because at that time, the board, prior to July 1, 2011, all board members were in fact appointed by the governor. And I'll get to that in a minute, but basically as of July 1, 2011, statute was changed so that our board is now designated as two administration officials plus one seat by the governor and eight independent board members. So as of 2011, fiscal 12, that governance structure changed very dramatically. So in that year of 2015, the executive director, myself, became aware of significantly outdated language that had been included in the CAFR, including erroneously listing our address as 58 East State Street, which had not been the case since 2002. So we then contacted John Becker at the Department of Budget and Management, and updated him on VSJF statute change in 2011. He then decided to undergo a review of the VSJF statute vis-a-vis the state and issued a finding that as of fiscal 16, VSJF is no longer considered a component unit of the state of Vermont. As of fiscal 16, VSJF no longer supplies its financial audit to state for inclusion in the CAFR. Had Mr. Becker known of the jobs fund statute change in 2011, we believe this determination would have been made shortly thereafter. And I have attached in the my written testimony a copy of the letter from Mr. Becker and his justification for why he determined what he determined. So as a small staff of 10 without any standard administrative support, it would fall on me, the executive director, to manage all public information requests. We just don't have the capacity to manage additional requests outside of what we already make available. Doing so would represent a significant burden that we do not believe is justified given the amount of information and reporting already provided by us as an independent organization, both to the state and to with those couple of documents that I mentioned that we all already make available. S305 also tries to subject any subsidiary of the Sustainable Jobs Fund to the Public Records Act. To state for the record, VSJF does not own a subsidiary entity. The Sustainable Jobs Fund has a minority equity investment in the Flexible Capital Fund, L3C, the Flex Fund, which is a separate for-profit company, and we have a 21.67% ownership stake in that company. As a for-profit company, its own with its own governance board of managers, 38 accredited investors, and 16 for-profit portfolio companies, the Flex Fund would be exempt from Act 1 VSA Squiggle 317C9, which applies to confidential business information. Additionally, the Flex Fund is certified as a community development financing institution by the U.S. Treasury, which requires for certification purposes that there is no state control over the Flexible Capital Fund's decision making. All decisions about the Flex Fund are made exclusively by the Flex Fund's Board of Managers. So sort of further justification that entity, meaning the Flexible Capital Fund L3C, should also not be subject to a Public Records Act because they are a for-profit company, and anything that might get requested of them would be exempted from the act. The VSJF has a contractual agreement with the Flex Fund to provide fund management services for a fee-for-service arrangement. VSJF as an organization and all its board members and staff have signed confidentiality agreements that prevent it from disclosing financial information about the Flexible Capital Fund or information about the fund's investors or portfolio companies. Again, because of trade secrets and traditional business exemptions. If the VSJF were subject to the Public Records Act, any Flexible Capital Fund financial audits in its possession would be protected from public disclosure by 1 VSA Squiggle 317C9, which applies to confidential business information, which gives its ownership to an opportunity to obtain business advantage over competitors. The Vermont Supreme Court has applied this exemption to private financial information, Springfield Terminal Railway Company versus Agency of Transportation et al. The Flexible Capital Fund's financial audits and management letters are confidential business information belonging to the Flex Fund. And it's not something that the Sustainable Jobs Fund would be able to disclose if requested. That's what we contend. And there's a list of some of the other exemptions that we believe would apply to the Flexible Capital Fund. So as I mentioned, we did provide the letter from John Becker from 2017, along with his justification why he does not think the Sustainable Jobs Fund is a component unit of the state, which is just one piece of our reasoning for why we would thus not be considered a public agency and thus should not fall under the state's Public Records Act. Therein lies my testimony.
Thank you.
Any questions, Randy?
Randy.
I'm thinking of Randy Brocker because Brian, you were.
I was on the bill.
No. You were on the bill also.
No.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I like the way you refer to the squiggles.
You know, I never know
it's sectioned.
I know.
It's sectioned.
Oh, is that what that is?
I believe tire is sectioned. Yes. I'm so glad that all these long terms are.
I don't know. I think it should be called a squiggle.
It doesn't mean like section at all.
It's what it means, though.
No.
I guess I would just like to ask Tucker, what is the definition of a state entity?
Well, if we look at the, I think that we need to look at what the bill proposes, because it expands it dramatically.
The bill mentions the stable jobs fund, but it's not to go much further than that.
It specifically calls that out, but it also considerably expands what a public agency is here. I mean, it would be
a public agency, not a public entity.
It would be, in my opinion. Tucker, would you join us? Thank you, Ellen.
Yeah, thank you.
Would you join us? Because the way I read this, it would be anybody who has a contract to do a state function, which could be Pike Industries paving the road, because they perform a state function, which is keeping the highways. So it would, anybody who has any contract with the state would be covered under this. Am I wrong in reading it that way?
Good afternoon, Tucker Anderson with the Office of Legislative Counsel.
Wrong, just wrong.
He's too politic for that.
That would be an incorrect reading of the bill.
Okay.
So the definition of public agency and the way that is it extended here, it would apply to any person that first, let's deal with the relationship to the state, that is through a contract, that would be one venue, through a directive and statute or rule, that would be another way, performing a governmental function, that is one way you would get captured, administering public funds, or implementing a state or local program.
So performing, administering.
If you're doing any one of those things.
Or what's the third one?
Performing the governmental function, administering public funds, implementing a state or local program. The relationship, again, is that you are doing this pursuant to a directive and statute, administrative rule, then we deal with the local set, ordinance, or contract with the state or its political subdivisions. You heard some testimony, what it seems like months ago, but I think it was just only a few weeks ago, about the governmental function test that has been applied in two Superior Court decisions in Vermont. Vermont Information Technology Leaders was one of the nonprofits that test was applied to. The other was the Corrections Corporation of America. That test has been used and applied in a plurality of states to identify when a nonprofit entity is acting as a governmental entity, performing a governmental function. The test that is applied is typically a balancing test, and there are four factors that those courts look at. They weigh them, but ultimately what they are trying to identify is this entity performing a governmental function on behalf of the state or a political subdivision, right? And should they be subject to the same transparency laws? And the policy decision that is typically made there is, should the state or its political subdivisions be capable of avoiding those transparency laws by delegating its authority to a non-governmental entity? Some states, and one that I know for certain, and in particular, Connecticut, have taken this test and put them into either their Freedom of Information laws or their Public Records Acts. That is kind of the walkthrough of the definition, how it might apply. As far as particular objections to the application in the bill of the Public Records Act to specific entities, there's an argument that even without that subdivision in Section 3 of the bill, it would add the subsections that apply the Public Records Act to the Vermont Sustainable Jobs Fund, that the fund would still be covered by the definition of public agency as presented in the bill.
Right, right. You don't need to.
You don't need
there because it'll be covered under the new.
Right. So,
can I just have a, you said nonprofit. This, I don't see that anywhere in here. It doesn't say nonprofit. It says
any person.
Any person.
Yes.
And a person is a corporation. So if the town of Putney hires Joe Blow to pave, to do some road work on East Putney Falls Road, they are now subject to, Joe Blow's company is now subject to public records.
If they meet one of those three
they're doing a governmental function. Or they're administering public funds. Well, they're not administering public funds, but they are doing a governmental function, which is to take care of the roads. That is a governmental function. It's one of the few that that municipalities have. Or, and they're doing it by contract. So I don't see who this doesn't cover.
In Putney B, you mean the expansion? And
yeah.
Just, it's huge.
I don't think
would it cover the Works Council, the BSO?
Who does it not cover?
That is a great question.
The press.
No, they are doing a governmental function.
Yes,
the press informing people about what's happening?
And they take those ads.
Governmental function is to inform people what's going on. And so, we'll extend it to the, they're right, but no.
And the bill is introduced, governmental function is not defined. There is ambiguity there. There's the potential that it could be tied to another phrase that has less ambiguity, which would be the business of the public agency, right? That is a phrase that we deal with quite a bit in the Public Records Act when we're dealing with the definition of public records, records that are produced in the course of agency business. So,
but if all these other people aren't part of an agency but are doing it under a contract, they're contracting with the town of Putney, which is a political subdivision. And they're doing business for that public agency. And they are doing a governmental function, which is maintaining the roads. One of the very few that select boards are allowed to do because we like to tell them what else they can do. I just have to get that little ad in there. That's called
BSA
product placement.
Section 2291, subdivision 4.
So they would be covered.
I will, for the second time in the context of public records, refrain from answering hypotheticals.
I realize that.
But it definitely is a broad expansion of this bill. And I'm just curious where the verb is in 2A.
The what?
In the actual current statutory definition of public agency means any agency, board, department, commission, committee, branch, instrumentality, or authority of the state, or any blah, 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 blah. It doesn't have a verb that does
what?
Those are all direct objects.
I know, but it doesn't direct, it doing what that is makes it a public agency.
They don't have to be doing any of it.
These are just who they are. They don't have to be doing government functions.
I don't think it needs to say
the
doing government functions.
Yeah.
Well, that's pathetic.
I don't think it needs to say doing government functions because it says it is an agency, board, department, commission, or authority of the state or any agency. So it's already doing government functions, one would assume.
And an instrumentality, just remind me, give us an example of an instrumentality.
UVM is a fantastic example. The emergency service districts all throughout the state.
State colleges are an instrumentality?
No.
I'm more fuzzy on the state colleges
I'm not sure they are. I think VSAC is an instrumentality.
VSAC, right.
VSAC is a potentially complicated example of an entity that is formed by statute that may fall under the definition here of public agency in 2B, I'm not entirely certain whether they fall under the definition of 2A.
I think that they probably do.
Once upon a time, the Office of Legislative Counsel was asked, I believe, by this committee to start identifying every time in statute that an entity, non-governmental entity, we'll say, a person, was established in statute to perform governmental functions. And the list is, I'll say, a minimum of 16 entities. VSAC may be one of them. The Humanities Council is created in statute. The state librarian was given authority to incorporate nonprofits to perform certain functions.
BSL was created in statute.
I don't recall that one, but it's entirely possible.
Anyway, there.
Okay, does anybody else have questions or?
I wouldn't normally contradict Tucker, and I'm not contradicting him, but when I read it, it does seem really broad to me. So I'm not saying you're wrong, I'm just saying for the average person who reads this, it seems like it goes well beyond the same jobs fund, it opens up a whole can of worms.
Yeah.
I understand you don't agree, but I just think it feels that way to me. Just needed to get that out there.
If I gave that feeling or said that I don't agree that it's broad, I apologize and retract.
Yeah, he didn't say that. He just wouldn't tell me who wasn't covered.
Right.
Okay, that's not the way to look at it. I think it sounds to me like everybody's covered.
Yeah, it sounds like it to me that way too. If you do a governmental function or administer public funds.
Right.
Or implement a state or local program.
If it would be helpful to the committee, I can come back with the statute in Connecticut that deals with the governmental function test and that incorporates it into their Records Act. And I can bring an example from North Carolina where all records relating to the administration of public funds are brought under their Records Act.
And what does administration of public funds mean?
The actual the management and custodianship of funds. So the reason I'm hesitant to jump into your hypothetical is because I'm not sure if Joe's plowing service was granted in that contract the ability to actually manage and designate where the funds are going. If they are just being given the money to perform the actual function, I'm not sure that it would fall under administering those funds.
But it does fall under a governmental function, and it's their ors, not ands.
I'll provide a more concrete example of something that would certainly fall under this definition. If a Vermont municipality takes their sidewalk maintenance fund for a fiscal year and gives those funds to an entity and says, implement a program to clean all the streets, and then that entity starts giving the money out to clean the sidewalks and streets, that would certainly fall under this.
Because it would be dispersing state funds.
Right. It would be performing that governmental function of administering the funds, determining where that money goes, executing those contracts. It would be an act of custodianship that would fall more in line with those tests for governmental function.
Okay.
This might be a way to rein in the state budget.
Well, nobody will contract with the state.
Exactly. Then we rein in the budget big time if we pass this. No one's going to want to take state money.
Yeah, any other comments or?
I am not supportive of expanding this at the moment, so I'm not a big fan of this language.
Anthony?
Well, the way it's written, the way I perceive it to be written,
It's a good qualifier.
Yeah. It just seems like it does seem very broad and would affect a lot of different things. And I think if we were going to go down this road, it would take a lot more discussion than we're going to have over the next couple of weeks. I don't support going in this direction the way it's laid out.
Randy?
I'm still on that bill, so I'll stay put with supporting it.
And you feel not supportive.
I am not supportive of this as drafted.
I actually am not supportive. I oppose it.
Yeah, well, that's what I was trying to say, but I was trying to be a gentler self.
I'm not known for being a gentler self. But it just seems so broad to me that I originally thought that there was language in here that said, if it's an entity that is created by the state and is controlled by the state, which I think VITAL is they were created by the state. I guess they weren't created by the state. I was on health and welfare when they were created and worked with Kevin Mullen around the creation of VITAL and giving them the authority to do it. Now, we might have had in the bill, in the legislation, that there was to be this entity, and then somebody came and said, we'll fulfill that entity. But it was a function that was created by the state.
I think the fact that these examples are popping up and each example raises kind of questions is an indication that this would need a lot more discussion. I mean, I don't think I'm not necessarily totally opposed to like what it's trying to do. It's just that I think it's doing a lot more than it's pretending to do. I feel it is. I really don't know.
And we have to hear from, I think at this point in the session, your point earlier is a good one, because we have to hear from and understand more fully the impact of anybody taking state money, what impact that would have in terms of their willingness to continue to do public service.
If we give money to the guy who's going to fix East Putney Brook Road, which actually I lived on East Putney Brook Road.
Oh, did you really? Oh, on Love Farm?
Further down.
Oh.
Anyway, I don't know whether it means that person would be subject to this law only while they're doing that job. Let's say it's a 6-month contract. Would they be open to subject to public records just for that 6-month contract, or is it ongoing because they did it once and they might do it again? Just a lot of questions. And I'm not saying you have to answer what I'm just saying. That's one more sort of question that I'm floating around.
Thank you for not making me answer the question.
I'm sure you would have had a good answer.
And with his 251 club, he might even drive down that road.
That's true.
Chris, you weren't here for the discussion, but...
Yeah, well, so...
It was called Flying Crown Ranch, by the way.
Oh.
I don't know if it's still there.
We discussed it a bit.
Yeah, based on what our last discussion, my position hasn't changed. I wouldn't support the bill.
Correctly. Okay.
And you only elaborated more reasons for why not. In its current formulation, the idea of access and transparency is always attractive. But what do you do to the operations of the entities that you bring in to that kind of requirement?
Yeah, I actually thought it only referred, when I was thinking about it, to organize things that were actually created by the state and controlled by the state. That's
so I'm just, for clarification, if we don't take it up and it goes back on the wall, are we finished with public records?
Well, we can, do one of two things. We can do that, or we could do a strike all and put anything in here that we felt was appropriate for, because it is the only bill that we have that refers to public records.
Right. Okay.
So we could do either one. And so what I think we should find out then is if there are other things that should go into other suggestions about public records. The one that we had sent, we heard from Chris Herrick and the dispensaries, and they are actually putting that someplace else, in a bill that deals specifically with dispensaries. They're going to put in there about allowing the working, they've been working, I think, with Laura Pelosi about the language about how, when complaints are filed and substantiated, that they would be subject to public records requests. But that, they felt that more appropriate to go in that other bill, so.
And that was the only other issue that I can recall.
Well, we had discussion about several other issues, and the question is whether we want to make statutory changes or whether we want to do a letter recommending best practices to the Secretary of Administration. I thought that was...
We talked about that. I thought we said that we weren't going to define best practices, because
And the other discussion that we've had is how one of the challenges that I think all our departments and agencies face is not only each one has different needs and different unique aspects to them, but it would be wonderful if, I mean, in my ideal world, the archivist would work with each department and agency to design the best and simplest way to collect public records and then use them. And she's on that, but I think that needs more encouragement because not everybody's done it. And the other piece is we really have to put our money where our mouth is. If we support public access to public records, we have to then finance it in the budget, because one of the reluctances, one of the challenges we face is balancing the time it takes our public servants to research and find stuff in a particularly very high paid ones. It's to find this material and make it available, and we are not currently, probably I would guess, in most departments and agencies, budgeting for that. And that is how do we push departments and agencies to actually budget for it? And just like we budget for elections, that's what we consider the cost of doing business in the state. If this is the cost of doing business, we have to own it financially. And then we have to, so how do we encourage state government to own it and budget it and actually adopt best practices in each department and agency? And that's, I think, our question still that we have. Right? I thought that was, and the question is, how do we do that? Do we do that with a bill, or do we do that with a letter, or do we not do anything and just talk about it and encourage it on the sidelines?
I'm not sure. I mean, you're right. You're raising the right question. I'm not sure yet what the answer is.
I would favor a letter. I don't think we need to do any statutorily. Asking Tanya to work with department heads to come up with a plan.
Yeah, and I'd love to see it. I mean, I think we need to see action on that, particularly given the court's decision, and I think that would inform any further work that we would do on it. But I think, anyway, I think those two pieces really need work. Best practice for collection and distribution and budgeting for it, and then people will feel, and they'll own it more as this is, we need to do this, and we have the money to do it.
So on the budgeting, you're talking about for records, implement the best practice of records, not necessarily access, freedom of information.
Both. Not implementing best practices for storing and maintaining records, but also the time it takes a lawyer or a very high paid exempt person to go and find it.
So we talked about this a week ago or so ago. It was like the idea of if we knew how much it costs, we might decide to write that check, making records free. I mean, it was part of how would you ever answer the question if you didn't know how much it costs?
Right.
And then I thought that you had met with the Secretary of Administration and it was going to be such a burdensome research request that there was, gave up on doing that.
Well, I just talked to her and I don't know. I think that, here's my feeling about that, is that if an agency feels that we shouldn't have to put it in their budget, if an agency feels that it's going to cost them $100,000 from their past experience, and it costs them approximately $100,000 to comply with public records requests, then they should put that in their budget. That's something that they should do. They should put, if the agency says, we already covered that in our budget, we are okay, we don't need to. It seems to me that that's a responsibility of the agencies themselves, is to put that in their budget.
They're not asking for appropriations suggests, and they're providing the service already, they've just taken it on as a cost of doing business already.
And many of them do, and some of them.
I think that's the question.
Is there not already in statute, I seem to recall a couple years ago, that there's supposed to be a contact person or
yes.
someone in each agency that acts as a liaison for people requesting public mm-hmm. records?
Yes, there
so, is. So I don't know what else you could do. I mean,
okay. And we have this little audit. We can encourage them to keep doing this audit and
exactly.
and getting more people to level 3.
Yes, given most of them are level 1.
I'm assuming that level 1 is the worst.
I think so. I think Tom has said.
Yeah.
Yes.
At least advanced.
You don't want to be number 1.
You don't want to be number 1.
So one of the things that she said was that the Agency of Human Services has been the best, one of the best in complying. And the reason for that is they have assigned somebody that actually works with her as a records something something or other. She had a name for it, whatever she is. And
records manager or
whatever. And that they actually have that person. And if you look at them, there are a couple, there are 2s and 3s here. There's nobody in the Agency of Human Services. Agency of Human Services, yeah. That is a 1. So clearly what we need to do is make sure that those other agencies have assign a similar
so
person to
work. So Madam Chair, the question for me is how do we get them there? How do we encourage them to get there? To 3s. Can we have a competition? I mean, how do we get them to 3? We could have the legislative records marathon. I mean, how do we get them there?
We could put something in statute that by such and such a date, everybody has to have a records management. They can't just have the point person, that they have to actually have this person. Or we could do it by letter. Chris?
Sure. For the record, Chris Winters, Deputy Secretary of State, and I appreciate the committee's focus on records management. I think that's a big part of the puzzle here. It's a key to making us more responsive as state agencies to records requests if we know where things are and it's easy to find them. I did just want to add that there is a requirement in statute already for reporting into a public records system. The agency of administration is in charge of that. So they're collecting information. I think they revamped it about a year ago.
Yeah.
So they've got some better data now. I did speak to Secretary Young about this yesterday. And she says they'll have some better data to report on. They don't necessarily segregate out what kinds of costs. You know, they have how much is charged for a records request. But they're not separating out, you know, is that time of the copier? Is that cost of the paper? Is that a high level research, you know, exempt person as you were talking about who's having to redact some of this information? But I don't know that you can get your hands or arms around this or head around this until you know exactly what those costs are. So that's one piece of the puzzle. We have varying success with agencies, as Tanya has said. Some really they realize that records management is a benefit for them. It's going to make their lives easier if they do it.
And cost less.
And so the investment is worth it, but it's almost never the top priority unless you have a position dedicated to it. So So there is a records officer designated for every agency, the point person who's responsible for complying with responding to records requests. I'm it for the Secretary of State's office. Every agency has one. But those are different than the people who are managing the records day to day, making sure you have a policy on what you do with that piece of paper or email when it comes across your desk. So I'm trying to think, are there ways that you could help us be a little bit more pushing into those agencies and doing their records management better? It's already in statute. A lot of this is already in statute.
Right.
It's just a matter of changing the culture
and
the resources are necessary. Some of these agencies just don't have a person dedicated to it, don't have the time.
That's a big piece.
Some of it is resource allocation.
So would it be helpful then for us to do a letter in encouraging the work that's already begun and encouraging more of it, and in fact, identifying what they're, if they were doing it at a three, what it would actually cost those departments so that we can actually get state government to budget for it?
I think you referred to what Tanya has said has worked really well at AHS is we have a position we embedded in the agency. That position just focuses.
Oh, like the AG's office. You just put position.
It's our position, we put it in. They work. Eventually the agency absorbs the position. We get another position.
And
we've done it with AHS. I think we're working on it with another agency now, which one slips my mind. But that's been a good model.
That's a great idea.
So far.
What if we gave you three more positions this year?
That would be ideal. I mean, then you implant them into the agencies, you train them up in records management within the agency. They take care of a lot of the procedures, the issues that are with records management. The agency then takes on the position.
Mm-hmm. So then you get through the agencies faster.
You do.
I mean, if you had more positions, if you had the positions.
Yep.
It's another $500,000 in chance.
That's what happened, I want to say 4 or 5 years ago, when the Secretary of Administration was Justin Johnson. We were kind of begging for these positions to do more records management, and we got the three positions at that time from the pool. Because they made the determination that we really do need to focus on records management. It's an investment. It's going to save us money in the long run. It saves you the legal liability. It saves you the people chasing down records that they can't find.
So I do know that I spoke with Rebecca Kelly yesterday, and I do know that they are working on this thing, so maybe we can convince them to take three more positions out of the pool and give them to you.
Good idea.
I support that. Because the other issue that people have been promoting is an ombudsman.
I heard about that.
But for my part, I would rather have those positions embedded into the agencies. And then, and see if that makes it any difference than have one person as an ombudsman, because it won't be one person as an ombudsman, then they'll have to be staff people around it, and then they'll have to have a desk and then a phone and you know how that works.
Yeah. That was your Minnesota company.
Yeah.
You know.
I didn't mean to do that. That's scary. So, where are we?
We're looking like a letter. I mean, or a communication, a memo or something, I think, that to the Secretary of the Agency of Administration, encouraging a rollout of embedding further people that clearly, when you embed these people, that it shows progress in public records management. But also, I think the second piece of that is taking on board what budget impact it has for us to incorporate public records really as a part of doing the state's business. And what does that mean financially to the state?
We could get you a page or two on how the program has rolled out in AHS and why we think it's successful and how we would envision it in other agencies.
Well, and what they allocate to it financially would be very interesting.
And then what I would ask is for input from the people out there in the world who actually make these requests and want them a lot from the media, I would suggest, is in your ideal world, which are the three, if we got these three positions, which are the three agencies that would actually benefit the most from having them first? Because they're going to have to make some decisions.
Or departments, agencies.
Yeah. But where is the best place to put them in terms of who currently is the most reluctant, recalcitrant, whatever?
There are lots of options on this list.
Yeah, but there are some that may be much harder to get public records from. We heard at the thing the other night is that many agencies, their answer is an automatic no. That's the first response. It's like people applying for disability with Social Security, no. They all get a no right away, and then Social Security depends on them. About 40%, about 40% of them, when they hear no, they don't appeal. Then on the second round, they again deny a whole set of people. So in the end, if you had 100 people applying, you might have 4 people that end up actually getting it, even though the other 96 probably were also qualified. Yes. That's the way Social Security works. It's an automatic no the first time, except in very egregious. I mean, probably if you lost both arms and both legs, they might say yes, but probably not.
Are we presuming if we go down this road that we're making an assumption, or do we have to reconfirm the fact that of what the recent court decision said? You know, about free inspection.
What? I was wondering about that too.
I think the court decision stand is there.
Yeah.
I mean, it is there. I just don't know whether we. I still feel a need in the sense to like make sure that we've confirmed it as a legislative body, so that the administration will continue to take it seriously. I know some people think it's unnecessary. I'm not going to argue it necessarily, but I have this thing that makes me wonder whether people backslide, whether the court decision is there or not.
They interpreted the language the way it is.
Right.
So the way the language is right now is what the court says.
Right.
That's the way it is. I don't know that. We can't make it clearer because they've already said this. We've interpreted your language.
Yeah, but. On the other hand, the Attorney General seems to be interpreting it differently than the administration. Unless I'm missing something.
I don't know that he's resisting it. I don't know that he's misinterpreting it. I think he's interpreting it
different.
It seems to me like he is. Like the court said this, and the Attorney General said it means this, and the administration said it means this. I think we all know what we think it means. But it seems to me like the Attorney General has a different perspective on what it means.
Oh, I thought that he just said he disagreed with it.
No,
well, no, I'm really
he's interpreting
the.
So the question is around what inspection means. Is that what he's misinterpreting?
I don't want to speak for the Attorney General's office. I think that when they talk about cost of complying, they are including research, review, redaction.
Yeah.
When
lawyers
other agencies
time.
Are saying, no, it's time, and the Secretary of State's interpretation has always been, it's time spent actually making the copy.
You know,
so it's different interpretations.
Right, and there's a whole lot of time before you get to make the copy. The copy's like the tail end of the process.
And I think the other piece that the Attorney General is talking about is when you take out your camera and take a picture.
That's
the difference between, even if you're sitting here inspecting, it's all free, and then when you go like this, suddenly there's a charge for all the work that went into getting that in front of you.
See, that's, you said more clearly what I was feeling or thinking. I think if that's the case, then I think we need to do something to make it clear.
I do think it's, for the most part, not a problem for other agencies. It's the Attorney General's office.
Right.
And I just am reluctant to have us dive in
and open this up, because the existing law, we can interpret it the way it is for most agencies. If the Attorney General's office is an outlier here and is looking at themselves as something different because they're a law firm for the state, then maybe that's where we should our focus and see if we can figure that piece out when everyone else seems to be doing okay under the current law.
So you think there's a role for us now clarifying things?
I think there should be. If every agency, essentially every agency is doing it this way, the Attorney General is doing it another way, I think it's incumbent upon us to make clear which way we think it should be. I mean, it doesn't seem right that we would sit silent when the Attorney General is doing something that we all think is a not good interpretation of the law.
So I'm going to hold my question for you, Anthony, for just a second, though. I think the chair wants to read the statute.
What is it, Title II, 316, did you say?
I was saying 316 has not been amended recently enough to be in the pocket park.
Right.
Pocket park, but it's one
which
BSA,
is it?
One BSA, chapter 3, subchapter 5, or chapter 5, subchapter 3. But it starts one BSA, section 315.
But, you know, as we think about it, it's not just the administration, it's also every police department, it's every municipal.
Right.
I mean, it's on beyond just state government. It's municipal government. It's Pledge Council. It's JFO. It's police departments.
Because if we all think, and enough people think that providing this information is the cost of doing business, you don't charge for it. And yet, it seems as if there are going to be more instances where the Attorney General's office charges people for it.
Well, if there's a cost, I think part of their point is there is a cost to doing business.
Sure.
And who is paying? If the taxpayer is paying for it, then it needs to be allocated to a department or an agency so that they can pay for it.
So they could come back next year. It's probably too late this year. But they could come back next year with a budget request. When they put in their budget, they would add X amount of dollars to help make sure they can deal with this cost of doing business around public records.
Right, and I think that's one of the things we could be encouraging.
Right.
And reminding every group that falls under the public records law that this is a cost of doing business. They need to budget for it, and they need to figure out how they're going to pay for it.
Right.
In addition to having a great plan for how to manage the records.
Well, sure, if it's a cost of doing business, that encourages them to be as efficient as possible, have the best management possible for the public records.
Right.
But if they think they're just going to send a bill to citizens, then that discourages
them. Part of the reason they're doing that is it's costing them money that they do not budget for.
Right.
I think.
Well,
is that
we
fair?
Know that they don't budget. They must be budgeting in some manner because they're providing a service.
I don't think so. I think this is part of the chafing about this.
Yeah,
have you found what you're looking
for? Yeah, I did. And I remembered it very differently because it says, and it's very interesting the way, when we wrote this, I think we didn't think very clearly about it or carefully because it says that you may also charge and collect for the cost of staff time associated with complying with a request for a copy of the public record. The time directly involved in complying with the request exceeds 30 minutes. But then down here it says the actual cost, which is only the cost of the paper and stuff. But so I have always been under the assumption that the cost included the cost to produce the document, to get the research and stuff. And for the life of me, I can't figure out why the Secretary of State's office, and then it says in here that they should do a, establish a chart.
Right. Yeah.
Okay? And they have a chart. And it says if you're charging for clerical time, it's this much per minute. If you're charging for manager's time, it's this much. If you're charging for attorney's time, it's this much per minute. Who on earth would have their attorneys standing at the copy machine making copies? So they must have, I mean, nobody in their right mind is going to do that. So why would you have, you'd have your clerical staff make the copies.
Right.
The attorney goes and finds it and does the work and applies.
Pouring over it.
Right. And then gives it to a clerical staff to copy, right? So why would we have the time for the attorney's time if we weren't supposed to be charging for that in the first place? That is the cost of complying with a request.
Yes, and I think that is what needs review.
And I for the life of me can't figure out why the Secretary of State would have made that chart.
Well, how old is that?
Well, it's from right here, but it doesn't make any difference because if it says here it's only the cost of making the copy itself, then why would the Secretary of State make that chart?
One of the things that we are doing is pulling the APA files from when that rule was put in place. So we've got kind of the discussion of what we were intending there, the public comment that came in, how it might have been modified. I think that gives some clues as to what was intended there. I can see the way that you're reading it, and I think I understand why the Attorney General's office is interpreting
right.
that.
Yeah, and so because I was here on this committee at the time.
So what year was it?
And
I think 96 was when the rule went into place.
Oh, which rule?
The uniform fee schedule for the Secretary of State's office that includes those.
But they've redone it since then.
It might have actually happened before that, and it was, I think it was redone in 2003.
Because the cost is not in the copy. The cost is in the research,
yeah.
The review, the time.
But the policy, the slippery slope is if you don't manage your records well.
Right.
Correct. You're going to be much faster if you manage your record. But if you aren't asking them to do it by date certain and budget for it and be realistic about what this cost of doing business for the state is, it's going to continue to be interpreted individually.
Well, it also says they can charge if the agency agrees to create a public record. And I'm not sure what that means, to create a public record. Does that mean to look at the record and to redact?
I think it's
what. Yeah.
That would come into play when the requester is asking for a record that does not exist, but the agency may have information that could lead to the creation of that record. So let's say the Office of Legislative Counsel had a master spreadsheet with information in it that might be responsive to the request. And the requester says, well, I want all the information from that spreadsheet and some associated information put into something new. And the agency says, okay, we will do that for you. But we're going to charge you for the time in excess of 30 minutes, and the materials used, and the IT person pulling that origin data from the database and creating this new record for you.
And how is that different than if they agree to provide the public record in a non-standard format?
All of these changes came from the 2005 report, which originated in this committee, on the complications of electronic data and records for the Public Records Act. And the non-standard format language comes into play when you are, for example, keeping your data in an XLS file. Mm-hmm. The individual says, I want it in a PDF, or I want you to print it out and give it to me. Sure, we'll give it to you in that non-standard format, but you're in vain.
All right, so where are we?
Confused again. I thought we had it figured out.
Well,
I was all in favor of basically doing nothing, mm-hmm. to change anything, sending the letter, mm-hmm. and to Ellen's situation, obviously, getting out voted, take her off the 305. So that's where I am. But to Anthony's point, that's why I was going to ask you the question. How would you clarify then? What's the phrase that we want to, or the phrases put together that we want to make it clear?
Well, I'm not sure. I mean, I would ask Tucker that question. Okay. But honestly, I think you take a line from the court decision, be clear about what it means to us. You know, the court said this, in plain English, it means this.
Right, clarify.
They said inspections you can't charge for inspection.
Right.
That's clarifying it.
Therefore, it's the legislature's position that you cannot charge citizens fees to develop the information, do the research, do the redaction, et cetera. You could, in fact, possibly charge them for making copies, if that's the case. But in other words, we would just say in English what we believe the court said. I'm not saying it very well myself at the moment.
Well, it's clarifying what copying means and what inspections. Right.
But they did not address the issue of whether you could charge staff time to redact and get this record
if it's going to be
copied. They didn't address that.
I mean,
I'm
okay. I think that's okay. I think it's, yeah.
Yes, Chris.
So, given that the Attorney General's one of the sixth, right, executive officers of the state, what's the legal relationship between what we define and the operations of that office? Do they have any additional latitude that other offices don't have?
With regard to?
Because he's an executive officer of the state, like directly in his own right. Is there any difference between how the rules apply to that office compared to any other agency office?
Let's set aside the two parts of the discussion and answer them independently. First, on the public records side, public agency.
Right.
On the records management side and the teeth that come particularly from, I'm not sure if there are the Archives and Records Administration, you have two independently elected executive officers. So requiring one independently elected officer to comply with the demands of another would create some serious government operations issues and complications.
Okay, well, that's what I wanted to figure out. So we could say something directly.
To the Attorney General, yes.
One of the things that was pointed out at the forum last night by the Attorney General's office is that they are in the position of being the attorney to the state.
Right.
They do consumer protection and that kind of stuff, but their main responsibility is to be the attorney to the state. So when you're dealing with the relationship between them and an agency, that's an attorney-client privileged relationship because they are the attorney for that.
Right.
Damien, I know you're waiting but you don't have to. We'll call you when.
I'll just come back when Gail calls me, yeah. That's what
thank
she just
you.
Waited
I'm
to
just,
me.
Okay.
Good.
I just sent you an email. So they see themselves in a slightly different position than the rest of the executive branch and the administrative branch because they are the attorney for the state.
Right. But
I don't see why that would affect their requirement to not charge.
No. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that many of the requests that they consider to be protected by attorney-client privilege. That's what I'm saying. It has nothing to do with the charging or anything, but they see themselves in that slightly different position than the Secretary of State doesn't represent. And the
if it's really a cost of doing business, which I think it is, because we've already paid for those records as taxpayers, so we shouldn't have to pay for them again to look at them or to have them copied or prepared or anything else. I mean, I don't see why. To me, there should be no charge for preparation or copying. I think the idea that you get into this thing where, like, we're not going to charge you to prepare it, but if you have to copy it, then we're going to charge you for preparing it. That makes no sense at all. I mean, copies are not that expensive these days.
So I would suggest that maybe Tucker bring us Connecticut and North Carolina? Connecticut was it North Carolina?
Oh good. Well,
information, and we can look at that next week and see what. Is that okay?
Sure.
Okay.
Is there any other information the committee would like on some of the other issues that you've brought up?
Well, maybe we could have, not from you necessarily, but maybe we could have either Secretary Young or
Rebecca Kelly come in and talk to us about the initiative, what they're doing.
Sure.
The other thing is, I think it would be great to get some legal definitions on some things, because if we're going to clarify things for people, it would be great to get some definitions on things like inspections. Don't know what that means. To me, that, or, you know, and where, why the words review and research and all the other stuff that's entailed in copying are not, or inspections are not, you know, where are those ever described as we talk about public records? Well,
yes.
The Secretary of State's office would love to bring you some legislative history and some history on the rule, so you can see the, some of the conversations that happened when this language was changed before.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
But I think where we are is we've decided. I think that this and open meeting laws are
always
in flux, and they're always a balancing act. And as technology changes and things happen,
remember when this rule was made, copying was 25 cents a sheet or something, and so copying actually had a cost. Where it now has, you know, your extra balance is like completely different.
Well, I'm talking.
And there's rub-on letters.
And then we have. Then we have Anne Galloway's suggestion here about clarifying that taking a picture of it was, if you inspect, that taking a picture does not constitute copying. So we can look at that language also.
Exactly.
Okay. All right. Is that where we are?
Yep.
Okay. Good. We are going. Thank you, Tucker. Aren't you glad you're the public records guy now?
Yes, and the records officer for and legislative council.
Oh, you are?
Yes. He has to do all the public records requests.
He's just done like two public records requests. But this is the question.
Tucker,
thank you.
It would be interesting for us actually to understand for our own legislative council is how much time you guys budget for it.
Well,
you can't.
We don't.
We're gonna take a 7-minute break.
He gets paid in chocolate.
It's all done in overtime. Oh, that's very cost effective.
We're gonna take a 7-minute break here because we have to.
Yes, indeed.
I have to pee.
Well,
okay. Phew. All right. Well, now we are dealing with another bill that we're just absolutely clear on.
Wait, which one?
307, the binding arbitration bill. So, where committee, I believe, have a couple choices here. We can do nothing with the bill. We can extend arbitration to the judiciary employees, as they are state employees. We can extend it to the state colleges, and we can extend it to UBM. So there are really kind of four issues here, four questions. And I would posit that the first one is probably, in my opinion, the least desirable outcome, which is do nothing.
Mm-hmm.
So where are we with the other three? Let's take judiciary first. Do it that way.
Okay. You just want a yes or no?
Well, I just want to know where we are, kind of, so that we can. Yeah.
I support including judiciary and binding arbitration.
I do two.
I do three.
Four.
Five.
Okay.
Okay.
So that's two sections that are in.
Okay. State colleges.
I support including the state colleges and binding arbitration.
I do two.
Three.
I do not.
I do not. Okay. UVM?
I support UVM as well.
I support UVM as well.
Me too.
I do not.
Yeah, I think it's the same as state colleges for me.
I would just remind There's been this discussion about whether they're state employees or not. And my understanding is that they are state employees for purposes of collective bargaining under the law.
Is that true? I assume it's
so. They're included under the State Employees Labor Relations Act. So for purposes of collective bargaining, they're treated the same as state employees, with the exception that when there's an agreement reached where the labor board has to settle the dispute and impose the agreement at the end, that agreement is not subject to a legislative appropriation. Agreements for the judiciary and for state employees are. But state colleges and UVM are not.
So they would, just to clarify, they would go through the same process, but not have to be approved by the legislature, that's what you're saying.
Right, so they have the same process throughout, with the exception of this option of binding arbitration or labor board right now. And then if they go all the way to the labor board and the labor board imposes the terms of the agreement, or basically chooses one last best offer or the other, that's binding on the parties, and there's no question of the legislature having an override like there is with state employees, where theoretically you could get the labor board's decision and you could say, that's too much money, we're not going to appropriate, you know, this much less, and then the parties have to go back to the drawing table within those constraints.
So that last case, so it's just the pay act in the end will govern. Is that what you're saying?
Theoretically,
there's
the pay
not
act.
Money there, whatever the terms were.
Yeah.
There's not enough money to fund it, it won't happen.
Right, so theoretically, you need the pay act to fund it. My understanding is that there have been times in the past where the pay act has not matched up entirely, but the funding's been pulled from somewhere else to fully fund the agreement. So this is, I believe, before my time here. But I think if the legislature affirmatively said funds cannot be used to fund that agreement, the parties would be forced to go back to the bargaining table and to meet the constraints that the legislature imposed. But I don't think that has ever happened, to the best of my knowledge.
And with the state colleges, for example, they would not have that decision-making process. They would just have to come up with the money.
Yes. So they would have to raise tuition and fees or pull money out of the endowment or, you know, just fit it into the budget somehow. Whatever means that they had, if the employees win and it's more than the state college would like to pay, they just have to find a way to pay it at that point.
That's true, whether they go to binding arbitration or not. We wouldn't be changing that.
You wouldn't be changing that.
And they have six unions they're already dealing with in terms of that.
Right, so you're not changing that. What this bill would change is just that option to go to binding arbitration instead of labor board. And that's a policy decision. It doesn't change and it won't affect this sort of, I'll call it the legislative veto option. It won't affect that.
But for purposes of negotiating, UVM and state colleges are included in the Labor Relations Act.
They're included under the State Employees Labor Relations Act. So I don't know what the history of that is. I would say it's not uncommon in other states to have a variety of public employees under the State Public Employees Labor Relations Act. In Vermont, we're somewhat unique in that we have six different public and quasi-public employee labor relations acts. Most other states will have one and then subchapters that govern specialized employees like public safety employees or teachers or something like that. But they'll have sort of one large act that they all fall under. It's a less states are kind of in our situation where there's multiples and we have, at least in my opinion, a particularly high number of the act. So we have municipal employees, teachers, state employees, judiciary employees, and then the two quasi-publics, which are the early care providers and the home care providers.
So if we're going to do this, I think we have to take more testimony from, because we have not had anybody in here to speak for the, for or against the state employee, the, except for Heather is really the only person that's about for the state colleges and UVM.
I thought we heard from Jeb at the beginning.
We did, and that was last year. Oh no, it was not.
No, it was earlier this year.
Okay,
I think.
But I think we have to. I think we have to hear. We have not heard anything from UVM. No, we have not heard anything from UVM, mm-hmm. And they have. So they have four unions. Is that right, Heather?
We represent the full and part-time faculty. Teamsters represent police services, and 9 electrical workers represent service and maintenance. So three, I think that's the three unions.
Do they have an adjuncts union as well?
Yeah, they're with us.
Okay. I was going to say, all the adjuncts and lecturers are under Heather's umbrella.
Yeah. Okay. I did reach out to the Teamsters and to the United Electrical Workers, and they were supportive of being included, and they're available to testify by phone if they can't make it in person.
Okay.
So, and then the professors are, of course, supposedly protected by tenure, but we know that tenure is tenuous.
And I would say, yeah, of the full-time unit, 45% are not tenure-track faculty. So it's pretty close to half and half on campus who are tenured versus not tenured.
Okay, so I guess we'll have to take, because I do think that if we're going to, that we need to hear from, UVM has asked that we hear from them, from not the labor unions, but from the UVM person. And it would be the person who does their negotiating. I don't remember her name. Do you know, Chris?
Who does the negotiation?
For UVM. They have a particular person that is that represents them, I think. I think that's what Wendy said.
Yeah, makes a lot of sense. I don't remember.
Yeah,
I never knew who that was.
I don't. So. Or we can just vote it out of here the way it is with a minority vote. But I think we owe it to them to at least hear what they have to say.
Well, it would be a minority, but it would be majority.
Well, I mean,
it would just not be unanimous.
Yeah.
Just to be clear.
I think it would, just because we've heard only one side on the UVM side. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
All right. So we'll schedule that for next week.
Okay.
Thank you, Damon.
Thanks for your time.
Okay. Well, I guess that does today.
By golly, it looks like it.
Come to our legislative reception, Madam Chair. 4:30
You're doing dinner again?
Just upstairs.
Oh, is that today?
Yes.